Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome back to Ecclesiastes class. Before I get started with this, I want to let you know that I won't be here the next 2 weeks. The next two Sundays, I'm going to be on a mission trip, and Dave Seeley is going to be teaching for me. Thank you, Dave. He's going to be teaching on Philippians, so please come on back next week and hear Dave. And also, if you would, keep us in your prayers. There's a bunch of us that are heading off into the mission fields. So, without further ado, let's get into our class. We are in class number 5 of Ecclesiastes now, and this week we're going to be doing chapter 3. And chapter 3 is the most well-known chapter of Ecclesiastes, and it's well-known because of a group of rock musicians in the 1960s. We're going to see that here in a few minutes. We talked last week about how Ecclesiastes all of a sudden showed up in the political campaign last week, and how the week before it showed up in the address to the United Nations of the Prime Minister of Israel. It's amazing how Ecclesiastes keeps turning up. So we're going to see how Ecclesiastes helped to change rock music in America, which is kind of interesting. This chapter is about time. Time is different for God than it is for us. If you look at Psalm 90, verse 5, it says that one day in our time can be 1,000 years in God's time. If you take a look at 2 Peter 3, verse 8, which is actually my favorite version of that, it also says the converse of that. It says one day in God's time can be 1,000 years in our time, and one day in our time can be 1,000 years in God's time. Well, if you think about that for a minute, you realize that there are 365 days in a year, so 1,000 years is 365 days. So one day of God's time can be 365,000 of ours, or one day of our time can be 365,000 of God's. By the way, if you multiply those two out and you look at the entire spectrum of time of ours versus God's, that's 365,000 times 365,000, which is 110 billion. So God experiences time, according to the Bible, according to 2 Peter 3, verse 8, at a rate that can be as much as 110 billion times different from ours. Well, Peter didn't really, I don't think, understand infinity, but my perception of that is God is infinite, time-wise, and that God is outside of time, that we experience time because God gives it to us as the currency of our lives. God gives us a certain amount of currency. He knows, before we even start our lives, when we will end our lives. And he knows how much time we have, and he gives us that amount of time as the currency that we can spend, just like money we can spend in our lives. And it's what we do during that period and how we spend that currency that determines how effective our lives are in so many different ways, in terms of our relationship with him and in terms of our relationship with each other and with other people in the world. It's how we spend that time, how we spend that currency that's so important. So this lesson is about time. We talked last week about the fact that Solomon uses the word God 40 different times in the book of Ecclesiastes, and he uses the Hebrew word Elohim. And Elohim is, there are three different words for God in the Bible: Elohim, Yahweh, or Yahweh, and Adonai. And Elohim is about the God who created the universe, the God who's sort of remote from us, if you will, who puts everything in place and kind of runs everything. That's Elohim as he's presented in the Bible. Yahweh, of course, is the proper name of God, just like I'm Bob, and each of you have our own proper name. That is his proper name. And the one that is used the most in the Bible is Adonai. And Adonai is the familiar way that we look at the Lord, the way that he's in communion with us. We use the word the Lord for Adonai when we see it translated out of the Bible, but it is also a third word for God. Anyway, Solomon uses the word Elohim 40 times in Ecclesiastes, and we have a certain amount of time, as I said, on earth to understand what God has done here and to appreciate it and to see what he has done under the heavens. And as we're going to see, this is going to start out with the words under the heavens today. So we have the ability to see what he's doing under the heavens. So without too much further ado, let me say that this is, as I said earlier, this is the most famous passage in the Bible. If you ask the average person on the street what they know about Ecclesiastes, it's probably the first 8 verses of this chapter is what the average person knows. And it really comes from a song that came out, and the song was created in 1959 by the famous songwriter Pete Seeger. Many of you have heard of him. He wrote a zillion songs in his life. He just died about 10 years ago at the age of 95, so he wrote a lot of songs. And he wrote a song where he took the first 8 verses of chapter 3 of Ecclesiastes and put them to music. And he called that song Turn, Turn, Turn. And he said that he only added 9 words. He basically took the King James Version, exactly, word for word. I'm not going to use King James today because I don't do the these and thous well, but they're going to use it here. He took the King James Version, and he only added 9 words to it. He added Turn, 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 the name of the song, and then he added the very last verse of the song, which is I Hope It's Not Too Late. And at the time in the early 60s, it was the peace generation, and the peace generation was about nuclear war. At that point, we were hiding under our desks in school because we thought nuclear war was going to come. And there was a whole generation of Americans that had a lot of songs about peace. Some of you might remember Peter, Paul, and Mary, and some of those folks who were doing peace songs back in the 1960s. So this was meant to be a peace song in the early 1960s. Pete Seeger put it out to a number of different artists. Most of them failed with it. And then all of a sudden, one group of artists in 1965 called The Byrds scored with it, and they turned it into the number one song in America and one of the number one songs of that year. It did revolutionize rock music, by the way. Up until that point, the British invasion had started the previous year with the Beatles, and it seemed like all we were hearing on the radio back at that time was British songs by British artists, and all of a sudden this American group comes along and reaches number one. So it began to change rock music back to Americans. So let me go through this with you, put this up here, and then we will talk about it, talk about what we've got here. This was on the Ed Sullivan Show.
What time to be?
Excuse us a second. So you probably didn't realize how much of an impact Ecclesiastes had on rock music, huh? By the way, just a couple of minor points on that. That was the Ed Sullivan Show. That was the original recording from the Ed Sullivan Show. And in those days, everything, those of you that are old enough remember that in those days, everything was in black and white, and one of the few exceptions was the Ed Sullivan Show. So we actually got to see this in color, whereas most of the concerts at that time were all recorded in black and white. But I actually found that one, which was in color. And the other thing interesting about the Ed Sullivan Show is back then, if you were a rock musician, you know you had really made it in the world if you got on the Ed Sullivan Show. Elvis Presley got there that way, the Beatles got there that way, and many others, and the Byrds got there that way as well. So, any rate, the date of that was recorded, in case you're interested, was December 12, 1965. That was the day of the Ed Sullivan Show, and it was the number one song in America. So, getting into the actual text itself, let's take a read through this. I'm going to read through the first eight verses, which you just heard up here. And I'm going to read the NIV version. They actually played the King James version. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. And by the way, the last verse Pete Seeger added, was after a time for peace. He said, I hope it's not too late, which was the whole peace thing of that time. So there are 14 of those in there. You might notice, first of all, that 14 is a multiple of 7. 14 is 2 times 7. Those of you that have been in my class for a long time know that I'm not big on talking all about the numbers in the Bible, but whenever I see something that's multiplied by 7, I've got a kind of comment on it, and I think I need to here as well, that 7 in the Bible is the number of completeness. And these 14 things are what, this is in a poetry form, you'll notice if you look at your thing, it's in poetry form. Poets use a thing called merism. Let me put that word up here for a minute. And a merism means that you give the two contrasting possibilities, and a merism means that it means everything, not just those two possibilities, but everything in between. So it's complete. It's a form of, merism is a form of completeness. And that ties back to what we're saying about the fact that there are 14 of them here. So each of these, as we look at them, we should look as a kind of completeness. So let's start with the first, let's start with the introduction. Solomon says there is a time for everything. So this is going to be about time. This verse is going to be about time. and a season for every activity under heaven. So everything that we do down here under heaven, which is under the sun, right, under heaven, everything we do here on earth is going to have a season, is what he's saying. And I don't think many of us would disagree with that. There are all the things that we're going to look at, I think we're all going to agree, are probably correct. But he shows the completeness of what's happening down here on earth. A time to be born and a time to die. Each of us is born. Each of us is going to someday die if we don't get raptured first. That is the completeness of our lives. And so we're talking here about the completeness of our lives. There is a time for the completeness of all of our lives, for everything we do in our lives. A time to plant and a time to uproot. Those of you that are into agriculture know that there's a time you have to plant. If you plant too early, you're going to have problems. If you plant too late, you're going to have problems. And there's a time to harvest. And if you harvest too early, you'll have problems. If you harvest too late, you have problems. You have to do it at the right time. But meanwhile, there's a whole process that has to occur in there. As the seeds you're planting germinate and grow and eventually blossom and turn into whatever crop that you're putting out there, and they get to the point where they mature, and finally they get to the point where you can pick them, when you can harvest them. So there's a whole complete process here, and Solomon is saying there is a time for that as well. And those times are something that in essence God has ordained for us. A time to kill and a time to heal. There is a time when things are killed, when people are killed, when animals are killed. There's a time when healing occurs. And there's everything in between that. Everything in between killing and healing is a completeness, a whole as well. A time to tear down and a time to build up. Most of us that have done any kind of work on our homes know that there's a time to tear down and a time to build up. You take the boards out, the old ones, you get rid of them, you put the new boards up or the new stones up or whatever it is you're doing. And that's an entire process, and that process has a completeness to it, starting from tearing down and ending with building up, and everything in between. There's a completeness to it. So Solomon's talking about the completeness of the various processes of life. A time to weep and a time to laugh. We've all experienced that cycle in our lives when we are, you know, one minute we're laughing at something, everything is great. The next minute we are crying at something, everything is sad. And we know that God brings us out of the sadness and brings us back into laughter again. So we know that there's a cycle to that, and we know that there's a completeness to that, that we will experience both of those in our lives, and we will experience many times both of those in our lives. A time to mourn and a time to dance, right? There are times when we're sad and we're just mourning whatever the person that has left us, and there's a time when we're just up dancing and just having a great time, and it seems like we don't have a care in the world. And that also is part of the cycle of life that Solomon's talking about here. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. Now, bear in mind, in his day, most things were constructed out of stones. They didn't have concrete yet. They didn't have sawmills to cut boards and things like that. You had to do boards manually by hand. You had to have a carpenter cut them. So in those days, it was about, you know, you could scatter stones apart and you could put them together. You could do that in your fields. If you wanted to open up a field for farming, you had to get the stones up first. You had to gather them. And then you had to go get rid of them. You had to scatter them someplace. So that was the reverse of this, if you will. But that was part of life in those days. We don't do as much scattering of stones, although recently this summer I had to get rid of some river rock at my house. So yes, that we do some gathering of stones and some scattering of stones even today. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. You could interpret that literally, a time to embrace someone, and a time to not embrace someone. Or you could interpret that virtually, and a time to embrace an idea or to embrace a change in your life or whatever, and a time not to embrace that whatever it is that is new or that is different. And again, there's a completeness to that whole cycle, just as there's a completeness to all these cycles. a time to search and a time to give up. So there's a time when we should be out there searching for things and looking for things. And there's a time when we give up, although I would say that there's a time when we find. To me, the opposite of searching is not giving up. The opposite of searching is finding. But as we know, Solomon tends to look at things from a little more depressed point of view than most of us optimistic Christians do when we're looking at things in life. A time to keep and a time to throw away. All you gotta do is watch the Hoarder show on TV and you understand that, right? There is a time when something comes in and it's precious to us and we say, wow, I'm gonna hang on to this. And then 20 years later we say, wow, I need to get rid of this so I can get this one in over here, right? Most of us, any of us that have ever cleaned our house know, and have ever cleaned out our closets, know that there's a time to keep and a time to throw away. Again, there's a cycle to that. Things come in, they seem to have meaning to us at the time, we keep them, and then there comes a point where we realize that it doesn't have as much meaning as this new thing that we could put in, so we need to get rid of it, or we'll have a house full of stuff and full of cats. A time to tear and a time to mend. So there are times when you need to tear things up, there are times when you need to break them apart, and there are times when you need to put them back together. Anybody who's ever been in a kitchen and cooked a meal understands that there are times when you tear the package open and get the stuff out, there are times when you put it together in the bowl and mix it, and the same thing is true of clothing. There's times when you have to take a seam out of a piece of cloth. There are times when you have to sew it back up. Again, there's a completeness to that cycle as well. Solomon names all these cycles. A time to be silent and a time to speak. I have a little problem with the silence part, but some of us do. A time to speak, a time when it's right to say something, and a time when it's right to just hold your tongue. And we all have to learn that in life. If we just pop off our mouth whenever we want to, we usually find people aren't as happy with us as if we use our words judiciously and use them at the right time. There's a time for that. Again, there's a process in there. There's a process when we can say a little and times when we can say a lot. There's a whole process there. And there's a completeness to that process. A time to love and a time to hate. There are the two extremes, right? Love and hate. I don't know that hate is exactly a word that we use a lot in today's world. Most of us look at that as not being a good word today. But it really is the opposite of love, and it is, there certainly is a time to love, and there is a time to not love, if you want to use that phrase. And again, there's a whole series of how do you love? I love my dog differently than I love my wife, right? Different kind of thing. There's a whole spectrum of emotions in between there. A time for war and a time for peace. You know, we'd all like to think everything is a time for peace, but the fact is that there are people in this world that war is important to them, and they make war. And when they make war, sometimes we can't have peace at that time. So again, there's a spectrum of completeness between complete peace, which we don't experience in our world today, and we will experience someday with Jesus, and complete war, which we have experienced in our world. Some of our parents have been in complete war, where the whole world is at war. So those are the 14 merisms that are in here, and again, they show the completeness of that entire range there. Merisms, by the way, appear in other places in the scriptures. They're not just here. They start right in, literally, in Genesis 1:1, and they end literally in Revelation 22:13. Let me, at the beginning of the Bible and at the end of the Bible. So merisms are used a lot in the Bible. Let me talk about Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Okay, in the beginning, God created the heavens, which is everything up there where he's at, and the earth, which is everything which is down here where we are at, and everything in between, the stars, the sun, the moon, everything. God created everything. Everything that is in the universe, everything that is in the heavens, all the angels, everything was created by God. So that is a merism to show us that God created everything all the way from his realm up there to our realm down here. So we see a merism as far back as Genesis 1:1. And then we see again a merism at the very end of Revelation, Revelation 22:13. This is Jesus speaking, and he says, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end." So Alpha is the first letter of the Greek alphabet. Omega is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. So all the words, letters, everything in between, that entire completeness of the alphabet, Jesus is everything. The first and the last. Jesus is the first thing in the world and the last thing in the world. He was there when everything was created. He will be there when everything comes to an end. And he's there for everything in between. So again, it's a merism. It's the completeness, just as we're seeing here. What was the third one? Oh, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. So those are the three different ones. Jesus was there at the beginning of the world and the end, the first of the world and the last of the world. So merisms are all throughout the scripture. They're in a whole lot of places. As I say, the Bible begins with it and ends in it, with those two verses. So it's certainly exactly to be expected that it would be used here.
As you're going through these, I keep thinking of David's writings, and he was Solomon's father, and he didn't pay attention to his dad's writings, so he would have seen there's a cycle of war and peace, because God called him to war sometime.
Yeah.
And there's a cycle of love and hate. David said, "I hate your enemies." If he could have seen God in everything in here through his father's writings, if he would have looked at them.
Yeah, we looked at a verse from the Psalms last week where David wrote, and that directly contradicted what Solomon was saying. I don't have the verse in my head right now, but we looked at it last week. Yes, Solomon obviously didn't learn enough from his father. How many of us didn't learn everything our fathers wanted us to learn, right? David didn't learn everything from his father that he should have learned. That's a big problem for him. Solomon didn't learn everything he should have learned. I'm sorry. That's a good point. So let's move on from that to verses 9 and 10. Let me read those to you next. Any other questions on verses 1 through 8? Okay, what do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. That's interesting. Let's talk about the depressing thought, the idea that everything we do on this earth doesn't really have any meaning. What do workers gain from their toil? So people are out working. We work all of our lives doing something or other. And we're working under the sun, sort of. If we're working under the sun, what are we gaining from that? Well, about all we gain from that is some food to put on the table and some clothes for our kids to wear and some things like that. But if we're working above the sun for what God wants us to be doing, then we gain all kinds of things from it. But Solomon's not looking above the sun. He's looking below the sun here on earth. And Solomon is saying, what's the point of working, right? Why would anybody want to work? He says, I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. So the burden God has laid on the human race. I don't know that most of us would look at it this way. Even those of us that maybe aren't super thrilled with our jobs probably don't look at it that God has laid a burden on us for this. You know, you need to do your job in order to earn money. You need to earn money in order to buy stuff that you need to live. And that's part of life. That is part of this cycle of life that we have. So is that really a burden that God has laid on us? To Solomon it is, and because Solomon has such an earthly view, he's very fatalistic about everything. Nothing is really something that to him is uplifting. It's all just normal stuff. Yeah, Debbie?
He didn't originally make man to work, though. I mean, like Adam and Eve, they worked, like he tended the garden, but when sin came into the world, then he said, you're going to toil.
That's a great point. Yes, we were not created this way. When I say we, I mean Adam was not created this way. Adam was created to live in a perfect environment. God created a perfect environment. And if Adam and all of us ever since then, for the last 4,000 years or 6,000 years, whatever, if all of us ever since then had refrained from sinning, then we would still be living in that perfect world. If all billions of us had never sinned over all that time, we would all be still be living in a perfect world. I think we all know enough about human nature to know that that wasn't going to happen. So God kind of knew right up front that we were going to fall at some point. It was just a question of when, and it happened with the first person in the first place. But thank you. Yes. Our life was perfect up until then, and it will be perfect again if we're with him. Okay, let's move on to verse 11. He has made everything beautiful in his time, in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. No one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. Every now and then Solomon says something that leads you to think that maybe he is starting to get it. And this is one of those verses. Maybe he is starting to get it. He, that would be God, has made everything beautiful in its time. This is Mr. Depressed, right? Saying everything is, God has made everything beautiful. So he realizes that God has made everything to be beautiful in its time, just like the Garden of Eden. He has made all of it to be beautiful in its time. He's also set eternity into the human heart. Now, Jewish people have a different view of eternity than we do. Eternity meant something different to Solomon than what it means to us as Christians today. To us as Christians today, eternity means the ability to be with Jesus forever and ever. And that just goes on and on and on and on, and it is this perfect state. Eternity to Solomon meant something different. It meant that when his cycle was gone here on earth, he's gone, but life isn't. Life continues on. His children go on, and they do things. And when their cycle is gone, their time is done, but new children come along and do new things. And he viewed that as an eternal process that will go on and on and on. As far as Solomon was concerned, the earth was eternal. And once God had created it, it was going to exist forever, and it would go on eternally, and people would just continue doing the same thing. It's a different view of eternity than what we have, as Christians have. It wasn't a view that eventually you were going to be with Jesus and be with him forever. His view of eternity was about life continuing on after we are gone. That was his view, and that it would continue, and there would be no end to it. So that was his view of eternity.
Bob, even if that was his view of eternity, would this almost be a little bit of a prophetic verse, because there's that place in everybody's heart that wants God, that needs God.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes,
so it's almost
absolutely.
A little bit of a prophetic spirit to this verse.
Right. Paul said that in Romans, that you know, all you got to do is look at the world around you, and you can't possibly be in denial that God exists. There are many people who deny that God exists. But I think, I believe, and I've met a lot of atheists in my life, that people who think God doesn't exist really know in their heart that he does. It's just that they know that if they have to accept him, they have to make changes in their lives, and they don't want to make those changes in their lives. That's my perception of people who claim to be atheists, is that they're people who do not want to change the behaviors that they're doing of their lives. Whether it be alcohol or gambling or chasing women or whatever that behavior is, or lying or pride, whatever that behavior is, there's a part of us that once we get into that behavior, we don't want to leave it. We want to stay with it. And I think that's really more of why people are atheists. That's my personal view. Yeah.
That just reminds me of a statement my dad said. I know it's been said before, but my dad was in World War II in Italy, and he said there were no atheists in the trenches. There were none. Because those bullets were flying, and they were facing death.
Yeah.
And at that point, these men who could go cuss and drink and do whatever else they were going to do and kill, suddenly wanted God to be real and with them.
Yeah.
And, you know, that happens with a lot of people with their deathbed.
Yeah, there are no atheists in foxholes. We've all heard that phrase so many times.
You know, I got a first-hand witness who told me that very thing then.
Yeah, well, you were a nurse, so you probably saw some people at the end of their lives who changed.
If you were a Christian, you died entirely differently than if you didn't know the Lord.
Exactly. Yeah, we've all seen that.
Entirely different.
Yeah. It says he has also set eternity in the human heart. So the human heart understands that there's an eternity, and that eternity is something that is different from our body dying, that there's a different concept there. And as human beings, if we know that God exists, we somehow know that there's a spirit inside of us too that is different. It's different than the spirit our dog has or our cat. It's a different kind of spirit that's in us. So there's a difference there that God has set in our hearts that human beings just instinctively know. Then he says, no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. So nobody, no matter how smart you are, how wise you are, completely understands God. We can study his word as much as we want, and we should study it a lot, but we will never completely understand who he is and what he is in this lifetime. Moving on to verse 12. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live. So again, Solomon every now and then gives us a little glimpse that he might be getting a little smarter on this. He knows that people can be happy if they do good, if they do things that are good for other people, and if they if they are happy, first of all, and if they do good while they live. So those are the two things that Solomon sees as being, anybody can be happy on earth if they have a happy disposition, or happy in the world, or happy about what they're doing, and if they are doing good in the world. So Solomon understands the fact that people who live to do evil in the world are not happy people. He understands that. He gets that. So we get little nuggets here that he has some understanding of some key points here and there. Let me move on next to verses 13 through 14. That each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that people will fear him. So Solomon understands, first of all, that each person has to work in order to eat and drink. If we want to eat in this world, we need to work. It's not just going to be handed to us. We have to do something to earn that. Solomon understands that. So he understands that part of the purpose of working is to eat and drink and have clothes and whatever. He understands that another part of working is to find satisfaction in our toil. People who are dissatisfied with what they're doing are pretty unhappy about it and usually want to leave their job and get out of it and go find another one. Some of us have experienced that in our lifetimes, where we'd rather go find another job than continue in something that's dissatisfying to us. So one of the purposes of work is to find satisfaction in it. So he just told us work is a burden a couple of verses ago that's put on the human race, but now he's telling us we can find satisfaction in it. So you're starting to see him thinking his way through this and realizing that maybe there is a little more hope in this world than what he originally thought. You'll see lots of this as we go through this, how he goes back and forth so many times. Satisfaction is a gift of God. Work is a gift of God. So work is not a burden and a toil that's been placed on us. It's a gift of God. We do it to put it in front of him. We do it because we are doing it for him. We do it because it is a gift from him to us. A gift of being able to work is a gift from him to us. I know that everything God does endures forever. So again, Solomon understands that forever is going to be there and that what God has done will never change. What God has done, there is no cycle to that. That is what God has done, and it will last forever. And he understands that will go on long after he's gone. God will still be, what God has done will still be here. So again, he understands some things about God. And again, he's looking at Elohim as God here. And he says, God does it so that people, then he says, nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. So we as human beings can't take anything away from what God does, and we can't add anything to what God does. It's beyond our power to change what God does. What he does, he does. And it's not something, even the most powerful king in the world, like Solomon, can't change any of that. And God does it so that people will fear him. Now the word fear is used here, but I would probably use the word worship instead. But God does it so that we will fear him, so that we will worship him. That's why he's doing it. He wants us to know that he's God. Yeah.
It's interesting that mankind is trying to create life or trying to, but they always have to use what God put
right.
there.
Yep.
We can't come up with anything that's not ours.
Yeah, we have scientists out there trying
to
clone
make,
people.
We can't create.
Yeah. Right. Oh yeah. That's. I could if I had the time, I'd get off onto the word create in Genesis 1:1, the word bara in Hebrew, which is by definition something that only God can do. Only God can bara. In Genesis 1:1, it's it is Bereshit bara Elohim. God is Elohim. Bara creates Bereshit in the beginning. And bara is something that only God can do. No human beings cannot bara. We have the ability, our artists can create a beautiful masterpiece, but that's not really creating. That's taking what God has already given us and putting it on a canvas, or putting it down in words on a piece of paper, or putting it in a song that goes on the Ed Sullivan Show. That is, you know, that. But interestingly enough. Huh?
The cloning stuff that we're trying to,
yeah,
you know.
We don't, yeah, we're taking what God's already created. Exactly. So we can't really create. Only God can create. And that starts right in Genesis 1:1. Let's move on to verse 15 and 16. Whatever, and we're back to poetry again here, you might notice. Whatever is has already been, and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account. And I saw something else under the sun. In the place of judgment, wickedness was there. In the place of justice, wickedness was there. So we see the depressing nature of Solomon again in this. Whatever is has already been. So everything that's around today has been there because God created it. It's already been there. And it's kind of what you were talking about. We can take what God has created and do things with it, but we can't ever change what God has created in this universe. It is all the matter that's in this universe is what's there, and we can't change that. We can change it around, but we can't put it into existence or take it out of existence. And what will be has been before. So things that have happened, so things that will happen in the future have almost certainly happened in the past. Not everything, but almost everything has happened in the past. And then he goes on to say, and God will call the past to account. Here's another glimmer of hope for Solomon, right? That God is going to judge evil. God is going to judge things. God is going to judge each one of us. Solomon's got to be sitting there saying, uh-oh, I just had 700 wives. I have been a huge sinner, sacrificing my children to Molech and everything else. God's going to judge me someday for that. And he's beginning to realize that that's going to be true. As powerful as he was, God is going to judge him eventually for that. And then he says, and I saw something else under the sun, and that's for the people here on earth, what's going to happen here on earth. In the place of judgment, wickedness was there. So instead of, and in the place of justice, wickedness was there. So instead of having justice here on earth, we find wickedness a lot. How many times do we see what sounds like it's going to be justice turning into wickedness? We see some of our courts corrupted. We see some of our judges corrupted. Some of our prosecutors corrupted. We see some of our politicians corrupted. The people who are supposed to be bringing us judgment and justice, many of them are bringing us wickedness instead. That's what's happening under the sun down here on earth. And God is going to judge that eventually, is what he's saying. Let me go to verse 17 next. I said to myself, God will bring into judgment both the righteous and the wicked, for there will be a time for every activity, a time to judge every deed. So we go back to time again here, which is what we're studying today. God will eventually bring everything into justice. Somehow Solomon knew that. I don't know exactly how he knew that, but somehow he knew that. He must have paid attention to his father to know that, because his father wrote about that. But somehow Solomon knew that eventually God would bring everything into justice, into judgment, and into justice. The righteous will be judged and the wicked will be judged. Somehow he knew that. We know that as Christians. For there will be a time for every activity. That's what we're talking about today, these 14 merisms. There will be a time for every activity, a time to judge every deed. There will be a time when every deed that every human being does will be judged by God. And that's coming. And everybody should know that. Most people don't want to even think about that. But people who've chosen sin should know that. We move on next to verse 18 through 20. And I'm going to read this whole thing here, 18 through 20. I also said to myself, as for humans, God tests them so that they may see that they are like animals. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of animals. The same fate awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. All have the same breath. Humans have no advantage over animals. Everything is meaningless. All go to the same place. All come from dust, and to dust all return. Who knows if the human spirit rises upward and if the spirit of the animal goes down onto the into the earth? Well, I hope none of us in this room believe that, right? Solomon had a pretty fatalistic view of things, as we're seeing from all this. He had a very under the sun, down on the earth, you know, under the heavens kind of view of things. He didn't have that heavenly view, that godly view of things. He says, as for humans, God tests them so that they may see that they are like animals. Well, we are physically like animals. We live and die and breathe and have to eat and drink and everything else just like animals. So that's physically true here on earth, that we are like animals. So that part is sort of true. Surely the fate of human beings is like that of animals. I hope nobody in this room believes that. The fate of animals is different from the fate of human beings. We have the ability, our spirits have the ability to go on forever. The spirit of animals, we don't know from the Bible exactly, but we don't see anything about the fate of animals going on beyond the end of their lives anywhere in the Bible. He says the same fate awaits them both. Again, I hope we don't believe that in this room. I hope we don't believe that out there. If you do believe that, then there's an answer, and the answer is getting connected with God, getting connected with Jesus. As one dies, so does the other. That is true. The animals are going to die, and we're going to die. Unless we get raptured, we're going to die. All have the same breath. Now, breath has an interesting meaning in the Bible. Breath means more than just, you know, the air that you take into your lungs. Breath actually comes from the word nephesh in Hebrew. Nephesh is back in Genesis chapter 1. I think it was on day 4 when God created the first living animals. They had breath. They had nephesh. Nephesh is a spirit that allows you to, it's more than just your ability to breathe. Even fish under the sea had nephesh. Nephesh is the spirit that is alive in an animal. It's the spirit of life that is in an animal. All of us have nephesh. We have that too. We have the ability to be alive just like the animals do. Then he goes on to say, humans have no advantage over animals. That is absolutely not true. Again, I hope nobody in this room believes that. I hope nobody out there believes that. If you do believe that, please come to Jesus and learn that that is not the case. He says, everything is meaningless. Absolutely not true. All go to the same place. By the same place, he means in the ground, because he goes on and qualifies that. He says, all come from dust, and to dust all return. From that perspective, that is a correct statement. We all come from dust, it says that in the Bible, and we all will return to dust in the ground. Our bodies will, and our nephesh will. But we have something different than nephesh. We have something additional. We know if the human spirit rises upward, and if the spirit, we don't, who knows if the human spirit rises upward, and if the spirit of animals goes down into the earth. Well, that's what the Bible's all about. It tells us that the spirit of man rises upward, and how to do that, how to have our spirits rise upward. Solomon wasn't paying attention on this. In verse 21, that brings me to the second part of it. And let me put these two words up here. These are Hebrew words that are all the way back in Genesis 1:1. Animals have nephesh. Nephesh is the spirit of an animal to be alive. That is the spirit of, and we have it too. We have a nephesh also. We have something else. We have neshama. When God created Adam, the word neshama appears in there. God created Adam. He blew the breath of life into him. In Genesis 1:26 and 27, God makes Adam in Genesis 1:26. He gives him nephesh. He makes him as an animal. In one verse later, he blows the spirit into him. He creates him And notice the difference in the verbs between Genesis 1:26 and Genesis 1:27. He blows the spirit of neshama into him. Neshama is an immortal soul, a soul that will be alive forever and has the ability to go be with God forever. And in case we miss it there, he repeats it again in Genesis chapter 2. He says that he makes him, and then he blows the breath of life into Adam. That breath of life is neshama. That's what we have as people. It is different, folks, from what animals have. That is a spirit, a soul that allows us to live forever. Let me get to verse 22. I'm sorry I'm keeping you a minute or two over here today. So I saw that there is nothing better for a person than to enjoy their work, because that is their lot. For who can bring them to see what will happen after them? So he says that we should enjoy our work, which is true. We should. We should enjoy our work. But he says there's nothing better. That is not true. There is something better than to enjoy our work. And what is better is to have heavenly wisdom instead of wisdom that's under the sun. And this is the whole point of what we're going through in this book. He looks at wisdom that is under the sun, wisdom that is here on earth, under the sun. From an under the sun point of view, that might seem to be true. But from a heavenly point of view, that is not true. He says, because that is their lot. Well, it is our lot in work and life to work. We talked about that earlier. That goes all the way back to Adam's fall in the garden. Who can bring them to see what will happen after them? The reality is, God does bring us to see what will happen to us after that if we choose him. We have the ability to choose him, and what happens after that is we have the ability to be with him, and to be with him eternally. And that's because we have this neshama up here that's different. Questions? Well, please come back next week. David is going to be doing a great class on Philippians, and the week after that. And please pray for me as I'm gone, and for all of us. There are 11 of us going over there. And I will be back in 3 weeks, and we will continue into chapter 4 in 3 weeks. And so thank you. For those of you at home, thank you for joining us. Okay.